This is Sheffield Hallam University Materials Testing Facility. We've got an incredibly wide range of materials testing facilities here, from the simplest, the most mundane test, to some of the most sophisticated that you'll find anywhere in the world. And I'm going to take you through some of the fundamental tests, both destructive and non-destructive, that we use to characterise materials. With destructive testing, we work the material until it fails so that we can understand how it will perform in a working environment under extreme conditions. The main advantage with destructive testing is that they're fairly easy to carry out. They yield quite an incredible range of information and the results are quite easy to interpret because we standardise every element of the test. Destructive testing is well suited for components which are going to be mass produced because destroying a handful of these components is very inexpensive when you think about the overall cost of mass production. The first test we want to look at is the tensile test. We're going to use the Instron tensile testing machine to perform the tests, and we're going to use three standard tensile specimens. The specimens have all been very carefully machined to be exactly the same dimensions and geometry. If we control everything and then only change one small thing, we can then accurately measure the effect of that one small change. In this case, we'll change the carbon content, and then we can measure the effect that tiny changes in carbon have on the tensile properties of a mild steel. So the first sample I'm loading is a 0.2% carbon. Here we go. Let's start the test. Following the tensile test, the computer will plot load versus extension on our graph, which is very easy to convert to stress versus strain. And we'll then get this complete stress-strain graph for the material that we've tested. From that graph, we can get some very, very useful information. The linear portion of this graph represents entirely elastic deformation of the specimen. So if we release the load anywhere up the length of this linear portion, the specimen will return to its original dimensions. It will not be permanently plastically deformed, which is also known as Hooke's law, where stress is proportional to strain. And if we measure the slope of this linear part of the graph, it will give us the Young's modulus. And it's a measure of how stiff the material is. So if you're designing a car or a bridge or anything that requires rigidity, this is a very important fundamental mechanical property. If you go beyond the linear portion of the graph, you move into what's called permanent plastic deformation. So this point is referred to as the yield point, where the material for the first time permanently yields. Then we have permanent plastic deformation all the way up to the ultimate tensile stress. This is the maximum load that will be placed on the sample. It looks beyond that as if the material is getting weaker, but in reality, it's necking. It's getting thinner in the middle of the sample until ultimately the sample fails at this point here. For a 0.2% carbon, the yield point is around 250 megapascals. The ultimate tensile strength is around 375 megapascals. And the elongation is approximately 37%. I've loaded our next specimen, which is a 0.4% carbon, so we can start the test. Okay, so let's have a look at the results for our 0.4% carbon sample. The first thing we notice is that the yield point for our 0.4% carbon is quite a bit higher than for our 0.2% carbon. The ultimate tensile stress for the 0.4% carbon is quite a bit higher than the 0.2% carbon. And the final thing we can see from our stress strain graph is that the elongation for the 0.4% carbon is actually quite a bit less than it is for the 0.2% carbon. Let's have a look at the tensile test data from the 0.8% carbon steel. The first thing you notice is that the yield point is considerably higher than both the 0.4 and the 0.2. The ultimate tensile strength is also considerably higher than both the 0.4 and the 0.2. And the final thing we see is that the elongation to failure is much, much less compared to the previous two tests. The 0.8 carbon steel is around the grade of carbon that you use for rail steel. Railway steel is made to be very strong, very tough, very wear resistant, and a 0.8 carbon is ideally suited for that application. Interestingly, Young's modulus is very, very similar. The Young's modulus is really a fundamental mechanical property, and it's very hard to change by doing things like alloying or working. We can conclude from our experiment that increasing carbon from 0.2 to 0.4 to 0.8 has quite a dramatic effect on the yield point of the material. As you increase the carbon, you increase the yield point. We can also look at the effect of carbon on the ultimate tensile strength, and we can draw the same conclusion. Small increases in carbon have quite a profound effect on the ultimate tensile strength of the material. And finally, as you increase the carbon, you decrease the amount of elongation. Simply stated, hardness is the ability of a material to resist permanent plastic deformation. And it's this property that we're going to measure using this Bickers hardness testing machine. This apparatus relies on a carefully machined diamond pyramid, which is pushed into the material at a constant rate and under a known load. And we measure how deeply that pyramid penetrates into the surface of the material. And it's the depth to which it penetrates which indicates the hardness or softness of the material that we're examining. We're going to use the same materials as we use for the tensile test, which are the 0.2, the 0.4 and the 0.8% carbon steel. And we're going to see how that increase in carbon affects the hardness of the material. I'm going to take our tensile specimen from our previous test, which has been lightly polished, place it into this jig, and place the jig and the specimen underneath the indenter. Then I apply the load through the foot pedal and this lever on the side. That allows for the indenter to be pushed into the sample in a very controlled way. That tells me that the test is complete. I now traverse the sample underneath the optical microscope so that we can use the dials to measure the impression that the diamond has made. So that is 613, and just to measure the opposing diagonal, that is also 613. So I can then look up under our Vickers tables for a 20 kilo load, and 613 Vickers gives us a Vickers hardness number of 98.7, and that means that our 0.2% carbon has a hardness of 98.7 Vickers. So this is our second sample. This is our 0.4 carbon steel. And that is 540 by 572. So that gives us an average of 556. And the Vickers hardness is 120 for a 0.4% carbon steel. And now for the 0.8% carbon, 404, 391. So that means the average is around 397.5, so we'll call it 398. And you can tell me what the Vickers hardness number is based on the chance that you should have been provided with. So the conclusion that we can draw from our experiment is that as we increase the carbon content of the steel, we increase the Vickers hardness number and therefore the steel's hardness. So that's hardness testing in a nutshell. It's very widely used in industry. It's cheap, it's very easy to carry out, it's mobile, we can do these sort of tests on site or in the laboratory, and it's incredibly widely used. A very valuable materials characterization test. So the next test we're going to do is an impact test. The impact test will give us information on how a standard known material responds to suddenly applied loads, such as a shock load, and then we can make judgments about whether the material will behave in a ductile or a brittle way. Essentially, it's a measure of toughness. So this piece of apparatus is called the Hounsfield Balance Impact Testing Machine. Essentially, it's a means of gripping a sample. The pendulum swings through and is hit on either side of the sample by a hammer, and it will measure the energy absorbed in fracturing the sample. The experiment that we're going to do today will examine the toughness of three materials. We're going to be looking at zinc, brass, and mild steel. The specimens themselves are standard length, standard diameter, and each of them has a notch. And the purpose of the notch is to remove the need for crack initiation. All we're measuring with this apparatus then is crack propagation, the energy to cause the crack to travel through the material. Everything about the specimen is standardized. We then change one thing and measure the effect of that change. Okay, so let's load our first sample. This is zinc. When loading it into the apparatus, we need to make sure that the knife edge locates with the notch, and then we release the pendulum. Okay, so it's measuring 2.5 foot-pounds for the energy to failure for the zinc sample. Those units might sound a little arcane. They're very easy to convert foot-pounds to joules. You multiply by 1.356. The reason we still use foot-pounds is that a lot of work done in this field is done by the Americans, who still use imperial units. Right, so let's remove the sample, the fractured sample. This is zinc, and we can clearly see that this has all the characteristics of a brittle fracture. Very flat, very faceted surface. You can see the light reflecting off the individual facets on the fracture surface. The next sample we're going to look at is brass. So we'll just load that into the apparatus and we're ready to release the pendulum. The energy absorbed this time is just under 12 foot-pounds, so quite a tough material. This type of fracture is characteristic of a high energy or tough type of failure. Instead of having that very flat, faceted surface, which we had with the zinc sample, this is what's called a cup cone failure, where half of the sample has this type of cup shape and the other half has a cone which matches into it. This is characteristic of ductile, tough material. Well, we're ready to look at our third sample. This time we're going to look at mild steel. The impact energy this time for the mild steel is 41.5 foot-pounds. So a considerably tougher material than the other two. And the fracture shows the classic cup cone failure. To create all that surface requires a great deal of energy, which is why this is characteristic of a high energy, ductile, tough failure. So before we leave this test, I thought we'd have a look at one last experiment, which is to look at the effect of test temperature on the energy required to cause the sample to fail. This is zinc again, and this time we've heated it up to 100 degrees C to see what effect that has on its failure mechanism. Okay, so bearing in mind this is zinc, exactly the same as we tested last time. The energy on the previous occasion to cause failure was about 2.5 foot-pounds. This time it is much closer to 20. 19.5 foot-pounds. So there's been a massive increase in the energy required to cause basically an identical sample to fail. It's no longer a brittle material, it's now failing in a very ductile way. So it's interesting to note that often railway rails will fail more in the winter than the summer, because mild steel has this transition between being a ductile or a brittle failure around 0 degrees for the higher carbon contents, the types used in railway steel. So the next test we're going to look at is the compression test. This is going to be carried out by my colleague Steve. The compression test is used to evaluate materials whose working life is in compression. A very common example of that would be concrete.
Okay, what we've got here is an Avery Denison compression tester. It's got a nice solid base to it, and the sample sits in there. It's hydraulically driven up and it goes up and up and up until it squeezes and compresses the sample to failure. The load from the test is registered on this display here. When it reaches its maximum, the machine automatically stops and reverses and gives us the maximum load on there. Okay, these are the three samples that we're going to be testing today, and it is important when you're testing materials that the sample sizes are the same. What we have here are three different mixes of concrete. The differences between the three are that they've got different contents of water in them. So this one's a 0.4. This contains the least amount of water out of the three. This is good for ramming up into curb stones. The 0.5, this is what's used for general cement construction because it's quite a strong mix. And the 0.6 has the most water content in there, so it sacrifices a little bit of strength, but it's good for pouring into complex shapes. Okay, so what we do is load the piece into the machine. This is a destructive test, so what we need to make sure is that the area is safely guarded. Pieces might shoot out when it fails. So we close that up. We're now going to turn the machine on. It can be rather noisy. And then we're ready to start the test. So we press the green button, and away we go. Oh, there it goes. For the 0.6 mix sample then, that gave a compression strength of 351.8 kilonewtons, which equates to the mass exerted on the sample by about 28 Ford Fiestas all stacked on top of each other. The next one we're going to test is the 0.5 mix. This is the mix that's used in general construction for bridge building and the like. So the 0.5 mix sample, that's given us a maximum compression strength of 433.6 kilonewtons, which equates to about 36 Ford Fiestas stacked on top of each other. Okay, the final sample then is the 0.4 mix. This is the one with the least amount of water in it, and this tends to be used for things like curb stones. So this is the failed piece. And this is how it looks. As you can see, if we turn that over, we've got bits dropping off, we've got cracks propagating right the way through the sample. It's broke. The 0.4 concrete mix managed a compression load of 260.4 kilonewtons, and I'll leave you to work out how many Ford Fiestas that is.